Okay, well, we've been talking about this resentment inventory. I want to share with you a story about what happened with my dad. Because this is probably the most significant thing that I've got in terms of really having a big change in heart and mind. I want to give you a little background on my life, so it'll take me a few minutes to set this up, but it'll help in terms of understanding what went on. I'm the youngest of five kids. I grew up in a family of alcoholics, and my dad was drunk all the time when I was a kid. My mother was drinking heavy, but she handled it better than he did, and there's 3 years age difference between all the kids. So I got a brother 3 years older, a sister 6 years older, another brother 9 years older, and one 10 years older. So I wasn't close to my older siblings, but I was close to my sister. She was primarily raising me. So that my relationship with her was, she was just dragging her little brother around with her and wherever she went. And I had a lot of fun as a kid. I was really quite happy growing up in that scene. But there was alcoholism. There was no discipline in my family. I was just out doing what I wanted to do, hanging out with my buddies, and that's just the way it was. I was hanging out with my brother Dan, who's 3 years older. But I was in trouble a lot as a kid, and I shared some of this with you before. But they were talking to me about why I was acting the way I was acting. Why is he sniffing glue when he's 11? Why is he in trouble with the courts? Why is he stealing? Things like that. And I heard it loud and clear. I was a product of my circumstances. See, that's why. Alcoholism in his family. And my dad got sober when I was 11, moved out, and within a year or so they were divorced, and then my mother married another alcoholic, and walked into the same scene, she never did really, I don't think, look at her alcoholism. And I was over there for my 15th birthday. My mother used to make me dinners on my birthdays, and she was drinking when we got there at noon, and by 3 o'clock when we ate, my brother Dan and I, she was just hammered. And I got in her face about her drinking, and I called her a drunk to her face, something that you just didn't talk to your parents that way when I was a kid. You just didn't do it. Nobody had to tell you not to do it. You just didn't. I didn't treat older people that way. We just didn't. Had respect for them. Well, it was a negative, sullen afternoon at that point, and it made for an ugly afternoon. And she was just hammered when we ate dinner, and I didn't like it at all. It was just a bad scene. I wanted to leave there, and we got a cab, called the cab, and when the cab came, I was just thrilled to get out of there. I just didn't want any part of that scene. And we left, took the cab a couple hours to get there. We sat in that negativity, Dan and I, and it was a very uncomfortable afternoon. When we drove away, she was waving, and I remember her waving, and that was the last I saw of her. That night, she killed herself, committed suicide, shot herself with her husband's handgun. And that's the kind of scene, see? So I grew up with that kind of a deal, and people were talking to me about why I was acting the way I was acting, and I heard it loud and clear. It's because of his circumstances. He grew up in an alcoholic family, divorced, now suicide, see? So those were things that happened, conscious or unconsciously. I think I blame my dad for that stuff because of his alcoholism. That's obviously why they were divorced and the suicide. I was a kid growing up. I didn't consciously do this. It's just, I think as time went on, I formulated this stuff in my mind. So because of my background and what was going on in my life, they were talking to me about those circumstances in my life. And as I grew older, when one of your parents dies, if you're under 18, the Social Security money from her Social Security goes to the kid who's under 18. Well, I was the only one, and I expected some kind of a payday. I thought that I would see some money when I turned 18, and I went and talked to my dad about that, and there was no money. He says, I was using that money to raise you. And I thought, you had to do that anyway. You know, there was some anger on that one, huh? I really expected that I could buy something, you know, a motorcycle or something, and gone, nothing there, you know? So there was some more anger toward my dad. And there were other things, you know, but it's just the way it was. So I had a lot of contempt for this guy. I lived with him from the time I was about 12 years old on, primarily hanging with my sister. And he was working for the post office, sorting mail between Minneapolis and Chicago. So he was gone for a week and home for a week. And when he was home, he was going to AA meetings. And I had no experience with him, really. I didn't care about him. I didn't care about having a relationship with him. It didn't matter to me, quite honestly. Well, I come into AA years later with all that stuff. And what do you do with that stuff? You know, most of us have these kind of deals going on as men with their dads. And some of you maybe didn't have a dad. Some maybe had them, and it was a nightmare, that sort of thing. I remember my brother Bill. He's 9 years older than I am. He had asked my dad to get somebody to help my mother because everybody knew she was depressed and she was having a lot of problems with the booze. And my dad promised him in a letter, I'll read the letter to you later, he talked about it to me, about that situation. And he never followed through with what he said he would do. And then all of a sudden she's dead. So he had a real problem, I'm sure, with that. I'm sure that was a tough situation for him. But I didn't know about any of that until later on. So I come into AA with all this anger toward my dad, and I'm trying to write an inventory on him. Now, I resolved that resentment that I shared with you earlier, okay, with Harold. I saw that situation differently. And I come in, and I got a lot of justified anger because people have been telling me I do. Probation officers, school officials, whatever it was, see. They were all talking to me about why my life was so screwed up. Because of your circumstances, of course. Because of those events. Well, I take a sheet, and I got to do something with this stuff. So I take one of these, a piece of paper, and I write down, I'm resentful at my dad. What's the cause? He wasn't there when I was a kid. Okay? My life certainly would have been better had he been there, right? I mean, I was grounded a lot as a kid, so I watched a lot of television shows, you know, Leave It to Beaver, remember those? Yeah, those were role models for what I felt was a family. Isn't that something? A fantasy family, a family that Ward Cleaver would talk to Wally and the Beaver, see, that sort of thing, you know, and he'd help them deal with their problems, and then everything would be okay. Wasn't that the... Yeah, Father Knows Best was another one that was like that too, see? So those were ideas that I had about what a family should look like. My family didn't look that way. So I had great expectations for my dad, right? He wasn't that way. So I'm angry because he wasn't there when I was a kid because he would have taught me how to have relationships, would have taught me how to work and how to deal with life situations, and I never had that. That's why I was angry. Now, what's interesting about that is my brother Bill died drunk himself. About 15 years ago or so, he ran his motorcycle through a brick wall, drunk. Killed him. That's right. Had a dog on the back of the bike with him. Killed the dog, too. So I know it wasn't a suicide deal, even though he was suicidal. He wouldn't hurt the dog. No, he wouldn't have. I mean, that's the way, you know, people who do that sort of thing are very conscientious about the way they... It's strange, but it's true. They're very considerate of other people, generally, not always, but generally about how they act out in those ways. So I know it wasn't a suicide, but he was suicidal and he had a lot of trouble. I talked to him a week before he died. And in that conversation, he was telling me how my childhood was worse than his. My dad drank till I was 11. He drank till my brother was 20. I don't know why mine was worse than his, but that's the way he felt about it. He'd been in a lot of therapy, and he never got well. He got angry. He just stayed angry. A lot of medications and stuff. He'd drink on the meds. It didn't matter. He couldn't stay sober. He wouldn't come into AA, although he was an alcoholic, and really get in the middle of it. He was on the outside, okay, kind of looking in. I was trying to drag him with me to go to the mission with me and put on a meeting and learn to meditate. So he wouldn't. Wasn't interested. Just wasn't interested. Well, in that conversation, he told me, and this is a week before he died, he was telling me how bad my childhood was and how I should be angry, but I'd already resolved the conflict, so there was nobody there to pick it back up at that point, see? Because this thing that I'm sharing with you, how it came about, was at about 2.5 to 3 months sober, about 3 months sober when this blew out for me. And when I was talking to him on the phone, I was probably about 7 years sober. He told me that he used to lay underneath his bed when my parents were fighting in the other room. So this is how hurtful this scene was to him. He'd lay under his bed and count the bed springs so he didn't hear the fighting in the other room as a little boy. I didn't have that experience. I didn't experience it that way. Here I'm angry because my dad wasn't there when I was a kid. Bill was angry because he was there when he was a kid. Isn't that something? Yeah. Which way's worse? Probably that he was there causing trouble, to be honest with you. I think I got a break on that one. But it didn't matter. I was still angry, and my anger was just as justified as Bill's was. But it killed him. Well, I tried to share some of this story with him, but he wasn't interested in hearing it. When we hung up that phone, I remember thinking to myself, how does this guy stay sober with all this hate in his heart? Well, he couldn't, you know, and a week later he's drunk and dead, in and out of the program. So that's the story of alcoholism, isn't it? Well, luckily, I was writing this inventory, and I'm angry because he wasn't there when I was a kid. Well, how did it affect me that he wasn't there? Was it my self-esteem that was affected in the third cup? Sure, how I saw myself, how others saw me. I looked like a failure in life. I didn't achieve much. I was just a failure. Did it affect my security, meaning financial? Sure, I didn't know how to work. I didn't know how to hold a job. I failed at everything. Did it affect my ambitions, my goals for life? Yeah, I didn't accomplish much other than I destroyed my relationship with Pam and the kids, and I lost our house and, you know, all those things. So I was a failure. Affected a lot of my ambitions, my goals for life. Did it affect my personal or sex relationship? Sure, I did not have relationships with people. I really was just very inept in much of my everyday affairs in life. Everything in that third column was affected. So I get to the fourth column, and it says, referring to our list again, putting out of our minds the wrongs others had done. Of course, in between the third and the fourth column, you're asking God to help you see it differently, but I don't believe in God yet. So I just said, I don't like how I'm feeling, that sort of thing, and I need to see this differently. And I go into the fourth column, referring to our list again, putting out of our minds the wrongs others had done, we resolutely looked for our own mistakes. I didn't make any mistakes. Where was I selfish? I wasn't selfish. He was. That's what I thought. That's what came to me. I'm not selfish. He's selfish. Look at all the things he did. See, I couldn't put out of my mind the wrongs he did. I was caught. I got caught with this in a big way. And I got stonewalled, guys. I could not deal with it. And I'm sitting in bed, knowing full well the process works because of my situation with Harold, but I'm caught with this one. And I took the piece of paper with my dad's name on it, and I set it aside, and I said, Dad, I'll deal with you later. And I went on to the next resentment. That was so important not to stop, but to keep going. So I picked up another sheet, started writing, I'm resentful at Pam. Now, Pam and I were together for 11 years. We had two boys. They were 4 and 6 years old when I got sober. I was angry because 2.5 months into sobriety, we'd been going to a lot of counseling. We'd been getting some help. The county was helping us with some counseling, and it was helpful, but I couldn't change her. And she was angry at me, and she had a lot of reason to be angry at me. And she left. So the final time, it was just over, and I knew it was over. It was done. So now, I got to deal with this. Now, I would have told you, this is really, I think, interesting too. I would have told you back then that I was very manipulative in trying to get my family back. I would have done anything to get her and the kids to come back. I was aggressive. I was threatening. I was scaring her. So I was just a jerk. But I wanted my family back, and I would have said it was because I loved them so much. Okay, that's true. There, that element is there, but you know what I saw later on? I hated my dad for breaking up the family when I was a kid, and I didn't want to be like him. And if she wouldn't come back, guess what that meant? All that hatred I had for my dad was coming on me. And she wouldn't come back. Uh-oh. Now there's a problem. And I felt the pain of all those judgments on me. That's right. So now I was really caught. I got to deal with this stuff. See, but so I'm angry at Pam. That's why I'm angry. Because she broke off my Leave It to Beaver family. My perfect little family. Now that justifies your anger, doesn't it? If somebody breaks off your perfect little family. Right? But I'll bet if you'd have asked her what it looked like, it probably looked to her more like a horror movie. You know, Jason with a hockey mask and a chainsaw coming at her. You understand? Yeah. Probably didn't look like a perfect little family to her. But that's the way I termed it, and that's what justifies the anger so much, see? Oh, yeah, if somebody did that. That's why I'm angry, because she broke off my family. How did that affect me when she left in the third column? Did it affect my self-esteem? Oh, yeah, I looked like an absolute failure. I lost my family. I lost my kids. Her family, her brother and sisters, my brothers and sister, my dad, her parents. I looked like an absolute jerk. Self-esteem, how I want others to see me, how I saw myself. That's what was affected. Did it affect my security, meaning financial? Not so much, maybe a little bit, because I had to get an apartment, you know, separate from, we were living together, at least at somewhat. And that cost a little bit. Had to pay child support, but so what? I had to take care of the kids anyway. That was irrelevant, okay? Did it affect my ambitions, my goals for life? Yeah, I had a goal to have a couple of kids, the American dream, the family. When she walked out for the final time, I lost my hopes, my goals, my dreams. It was devastating, guys, to me. I had a lot of family values from the shows I was watching, from whatever it was. I had these core family values. One of my kids is very much like I am in that sense. You know why it is. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it affected my ambitions big time. Did it affect my personal or sex relations? Of course, she left. It ended my sex relations, so that took care of that, all right? So everything was affected on this. I get to looking at the fourth column. I asked God to help me see this differently. Actually, I just said, I need to see this differently. So I go and slide into the fourth column. Referring to our list again, putting out of our minds the wrongs others had done, we resolutely looked for our own mistakes. Now, I was able to do this with her. I was able to do this with her. Set aside what I thought she did and just look for what I did in that relationship, in the entire relationship. Where did I make mistakes? And I looked at it as her and the kids. I had them lumped together on this one, okay? Just the way it was. And then I asked the first question, where had I been selfish? Here's how the thoughts came. This is exactly the way it come through that altered me. First thought, where was I selfish? The voice says, Rick. Again, one more time, Rick. My voice in my head, I have no idea why I would say Rick to myself, because I don't think God's talking to me, but that's what happened. I've had that a lot, by the way, over the years. Rick. You did exactly the same thing to your family your dad did to his. I said, what? Yeah. I did. That's the way it came. Yeah. You walked right in his shoes. That's the way it came to me. You walked right in his shoes. You weren't there when your kids were small. You were out moving your antique plumbing fixture store around town. You know what I mean? Trying to keep my house out of foreclosure. You know, all those things that I was sharing with you in the other story. I wasn't there when my kids were small because of things I was doing, the way I was acting. My dad wasn't there because he was working and he was drunk. So maybe the form of us not being there was a little different, but the content was the same. We both weren't there, okay? Form isn't what's important. Content's important. The form can be different, but the content was the same. Then I started to think, you know, the things that I didn't do with any malice or intent to hurt anyone. I was making choices, the lesser of two evils. Here's how, and what I mean by that is, I would make the choice that hurt the least for the most involved. I'll give you an example. I kept Pam at home with the kids while they were preschool. She didn't work. Before they went to kindergarten, she was at home with them. And I remember priding myself in this. I'm being a good dad. I'll sacrifice my relationship with her and the kids, all for the good of the kids and her, of course, you know, because I'll take care of them. I'll keep a roof over their head. I'll keep food on the table. And I'll take care of this business stuff and try and keep the house out of foreclosure. And I got to deal with these things. I got deadlines to meet. I got attorney fees for the mortgage company that I had to pay. And there was a lot of deadlines that I had to make to keep that house out of foreclosure. But at least my kids will have Pam there. I had no one. See, there's a lie. I had my sister. But that was a lie right there. I had my sister. So I think this is a noble thing, what I'm doing, right? That is not how other people viewed it. Pam's parents, her family, her brothers, her brother and sisters, my dad, my brothers and sister, everybody thought I was a jerk for what I was doing. I used to hear the talk. Oh, he's not around. He doesn't love his family. He doesn't care about his kids. Absolutely wasn't true. I thought what I was doing was proof of how much I cared about my kids. Now, isn't it odd that you get completely different perceptions from the same situation? Well, who's right? I remember thinking, if they could see from their little perspective what I can see from my larger perspective, they would see that I'm keeping Pam there with the kids. They would see that I'm grocery shopping at 3 o'clock in the morning because it's the only time I seem to have to do certain things because she won't get a driver's license and drive a car. There was a resentment, huh? I felt like I wasn't getting help in that sense from her. If they could see that I got to pay the mortgage companies, attorneys' fees, and I got to come up with these deadlines, if they could see I'm moving my antique plumbing fixture store around town, and if I don't get it moved and I don't meet these deadlines, I'm going to lose the inventory that was going to bail out the house. See what I mean? If they could see from their little perspective what I see from my larger perspective, they would see that what they think wasn't true. It wasn't happening the way they thought it was. Like a ton of bricks, I get this in my head. Rick, your dad's situation was no different than yours. Uh-oh. Could it be he was caught in addiction just like you were? Sure. Could it be he was making choices like you were? This is the way the thoughts were coming. Sure. Okay, I can go with that. Would I accuse myself of all the horrible things I've been accusing my dad of? How could I? I've just been sitting there rationalizing why I did what I did. It made perfect sense to me. See, the thoughts had to come in this sequence to open me up. And they came in exactly the right sequence. Would I accuse myself of doing this? No. And all of a sudden, the resentment just went bing, and it was gone, just like that. I went from hating my dad to realizing, my God, I owe this guy an amend in about 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Lifelong resentment. When I share this, it's so flat compared to the experience. This was huge to me. Whenever you're trying to talk about, put language or words to a revelation like that, it's always flat. But I got to tell you, it altered every circumstance around my dad. And the resentments never come back. Now, I had a problem. I'd been treating him for 25 years as if he ruined my life. You know how you treat a guy that's ruining your life? You're sarcastic when he's around. I'm slamming them to my sister and other siblings or whoever will listen. I'm putting them down constantly. I'm actively aggressive when I'm with him. I hadn't talked to him in about 15 years when I wrote the inventory. He'd been living down in Florida and he was out of state, see? But I'd still been slamming him to anybody who'd listen. I realized I got to sit down, I got to write him a letter, I got to talk to him. So I wrote a letter to him. And I sat down and I wrote thanking him for staying sober from the time I was 11, hoping I could walk in his shoes in recovery rather than insanity like I had. And I let a guy at a tech at a treatment center who was about 9 years sober, 7 years sober at the time that I knew real well, I let him read the letter because I didn't trust myself. I didn't want any anger in it. I didn't want to cause more trouble because something shifted major in me. The guy read the letter. He said, send it. Don't change a word. How do you go from hating someone to writing a letter with no anger in it? Unbelievable. So I mailed it off. I got a letter back from him. I'll read it to you in a minute. I'm during this period, I'm doing a lot of 12-step work. Because my life is a mess. I'm in a lot of pain over losing my family and this stuff, and I'm writing these inventories, and I'm doing a lot of 12-step work. I'm running around to treatment centers. That's one of the benefits of being where I live, is there's a lot of opportunities for that sort of thing where I am. I'm over at the Union Gospel Mission with my sponsor, with Joseph, and I met Joseph after this experience. I had already had this experience and sent this letter off, and then I ran into this guy, Joseph, who's 24 years my senior, and he became my sponsor. He was a guy who taught transcendental meditation. I learned to meditate, and I started going to the mission with him, see? So I'm in this process. I'd written this letter. I'd gotten a letter back from my dad, and I was going to a lot of meetings and doing stuff, and we're sitting in the group one day, shortly after him and I were reunited. I had known him from before. He looks at the group and points to me, and he says, look at that guy. He's grinning like that all the time. And I thought, huh? He's talking about me? I was shocked when he said it. Where did all my depression go? You know, when I got sober, I knew what a jerk I'd been to my family. I knew how I'd treated Pam and how I jacked my kids around and how they grew up without a dad in the house because of my drinking and my all the craziness that went on. I understood that. And then I was depressed and I carried it like a heavy weight. And I was feeling sorry for myself all the time. And all that negativity, it was all gone. When he said that, it shocked me. I just went, what? And then I thought, wow, he's right. I'm happy, I'm excited, I'm having fun. Where'd all that stuff go? And it occurred to me, when you let your dad off the hook, you let yourself off the hook. How are you gonna judge your parents for being a crappy parent when I've acted the way I've acted? How are you gonna get out from under the weight of that judgment? Yet I did. I got out from under the weight of it by writing inventory. And I saw my dad differently. I got this letter back from him, and in this letter he talked about some things, and I want to read it, but you see, my guilt and my remorse and my hatred for myself was tied to how I viewed my dad. My judgment of myself literally lifted when I was no longer hammering on him for ruining my life. Why? Because I made choices and decisions and my life fell apart. I made stupid choices and decisions based out of my selfishness. I wanted what I wanted at the time. It had nothing to do with my childhood or anything else. They were just stupid choices. I didn't ask my dad's opinion or permission. I just made dumb decisions. I lost my family, I lost my house, I lost my business, I had no friends, everything was gone. And I didn't want to be responsible for that, so I poured energy into hating somebody else for my mistakes, you see? And all that hatred and energy I had for him was on me. And I was depressed and I was miserable. But it was all gone now. It was all gone. I get this letter back from him. Listen to this one. This is dated February 25th, 1988. I sobered up September 4th, 1987. All of this happened within 6 months. Okay? Says, Dear Rick, I got... Now, here, Nick, keep in mind, this is a man who's 20 years sober when he wrote this. All right? He swept his alcoholism under a rug, pretended like nothing happened. Just pretended like nothing happened, you know? He's kind of like the guy who came up out of the cyclone center to find his house ruined. Don't see anything the matter here, Ma. Ain't it grand the wind stopped blowing? This is so offensive if you've done this with your family and your kids. Talk to him. Please talk to him. Don't do that. My brother Bill died drunk, angry at my dad because he did that. That's a fact. He was just rageful at my dad over that stuff. He knew just enough of the program to use it as a weapon. So here's what I get back. Dear Rick, I got your very welcome letter today. Believe me, it was a very wonderful expression of your feelings and your desire and courage to change your life around. I know how difficult it is to turn 180 degrees, but I know you can do it. You are going about it in the right way. I am very proud of you. This is from a man who never talked of feelings or anything. Nothing. He says, you know, Rick, we people in AA never get through making amends to people we have hurt. I have hurt you as well as my other kids. I can never complete making amends. There are some people I can never make amends to because they are gone. I can never make amends to my mother as I should have. Wow, he never cleaned up his mess with his mother. I can never make amends to your mother as I should have. He was 7 years sober when she died. Never talked to his wife. Never cleaned up the mess. He got all these regrets at 20 years sober. I just have to do the next best thing, and that is to work this AA program the best I can and constantly try to put into practice those seven little words of step 12. Practice these principles in all our affairs. Rick, you have made amends to me in a way you'll never realize. Just keep on doing things as you are now doing, and you will find a great life ahead of you. I do realize. You know when you get well, you heal your parents? Do you understand that parents feel responsible for their kids? I'm not saying they are responsible, but they feel responsible. I know this from Al-Anon, from being in Al-Anon. Parents are always coming in saying, if I just wouldn't have worked so much, if I wouldn't have been so harsh, if I wouldn't have done this, if I wouldn't have done that, or if I would have spent more time or send her to college, or because they got kids who are using, see? And I look at them, I say, look, if you think you can screw them up, why don't you just fix them? Well, I mean, you should be able to fix them if you have that kind of power, shouldn't you? Yeah, well, they know better at that point. So when I got well, I healed my dad. His guilt was tied to my being sick. It's like you're holding a picture of a broken person up in front of their face all the time, you know, saying, you're responsible for why I'm like, oh boy. Your mother loved all you kids very much, but you must remember that she was very sick from the booze and was not responsible for her insane behavior. She was sick. Nobody talked about her death until this. I never heard anybody say anything. Just swept that one under the rug, too. But your mother was a very good mother. She nursed you kids through your sick spells many times, and she kept you clean and healthy. I was to an AA meeting last night. Interesting how this coincided with my letter going out. I heard someone say how they had feelings of guilt about someone they had failed to try to help, and it brought back memories of my own guilt feelings. I had promised Bill I was going to try to get some woman at the club to see her, you know, meaning my mother. But I kept putting it off until it was too late. So I have had my share of guilt feelings. I have to use that serenity prayer a lot. Isn't it sad, the regrets that he's got? Rick, we are all responsible for our own behavior, but sometimes we are so sick we can't control ourselves and we become overwhelmed. But thanks to AA, we have tools to work with and people who support us. I want to thank you for your wonderful letter. You owe me nothing. I am very happy to hear how well you are doing. Your mother would be very happy for you. This is making amends too. am enclosing a couple of cards for you and Pam to carry. It's a very special poem for me. I sometimes pass them out when I speak at meetings down here in Florida. That's the man in the glass card. You ever seen that one? Yeah, you don't have to live up to somebody else's expectations. I don't care if it's a sponsor or an AA group or who it is. But if you're not okay with yourself, it's going to be ugly, man. And you know when you're being a jerk. You know when you've done something wrong. That card is really quite good. I think the meaning is very good. This will be all for now, Rick. Greet Pam for me and also Austin and Wyatt. Love to all of you and keep the faith, Dad. Wow. I didn't expect this. My brother, Bill, died drunk wanting this letter from my dad. He never got this letter. You know what the difference between my being alive and Bill dying of alcoholism is? I wrote inventory. That's the difference. And I got a letter that I didn't expect. I didn't write the letter to get this letter. I wrote the letter to clean up my mess because I treated him so poorly for so many years based on a story that wasn't even accurate. You know, he moved back to Minneapolis about the last 10 years of his life, 12 years, and him and I had a lot of time. I drove him over to the mission. I took him to that meeting with me. Every Tuesday, I'd pick him up and I'd drag him over there, and him and I had a relationship. We had a nice relationship for about 10, 12 years, something like that, and it was great. I'd have missed all that over what? An unwillingness to get honest, an unwillingness to examine my crap? Well, I wasn't unwilling. And I'm glad that I had the experience I had and the time I had with that guy, because he was a good man and he had a lot of regrets and he made a lot of mistakes in the program, as this letter tells. But he was a good guy. He really was a decent guy. Yeah, he didn't live up to my expectations. He was a crappy parent and he wasn't very good with his grandchildren either. He didn't spend any time with them. But that's the way he was. So what? All that stuff changed for me, guys. I don't know where that went. It just simply went away when I changed my mind. When my mind changed. It's hard to describe this. You know, the resentment didn't come back a little here or there. If it comes back a little here or there, you haven't forgiven it. You've pardoned somebody. This one's never come back. No anger. Nothing with him. When he died a few years ago, I had no heartache. About 3 years ago, I had no heartache. There was no unfinished business with us. You know when there's heartache? When you got unfinished business. Oh, it's a nightmare then, isn't it? And I've seen that so much. I am so grateful for the experience of AA, for the experience of this inventory. But the thing is, when my kids were using, I haven't had that guilt. And I didn't have to try and change my kids or slam them when they were using. And one of them got sober. And if I'd have been hammering on him and telling him how much he was hurting his mother and all that stuff that people do, trying to get somebody sober through guilt, he'd have never called me. But he did call me when he wanted help. And he asked me to help him. And I took him to an AA meeting, and I introduced him to some people, and I got out of the way. And I let it happen. And he doesn't go to meetings now, and I don't care. He came to a number of workshops I'd done, and he heard these stories, and he heard me share a lot of this stuff. And him and I have had a great relationship, too. But I didn't have all that guilt. It's the guilt that makes you want to force them to change, you know? It's your own guilt that makes you get angry. I saw that with my dad. Whenever I'd tell my dad how bad my brother Bill was doing, my dad would get angry and say, well, he should do this, or he should do that, or he's... Wow, I was hooking his guilt, and I realized, shut up, Rick. You don't need to do that with him. You don't need to do that with him. That wasn't helpful. And I stopped. And that anger's gone. And that guilt that I had is gone. It didn't mean I didn't have to clean up my mess with my kids. But, you know, I sat down with my kids and I talked to them. And I talked to them about my alcoholism. And I talked to them about what I was going to do. They were very young at the time. I had to talk to them again as they grew a little older. But I've had pretty good relationships. One of my kids is still using. But I don't hammer on him. I don't have to push at him and put a stake between me and him because he's using. So what? Let him be. Maybe he'll get sober, maybe he won't. I don't know what'll happen to him. You got...
Yeah, and you know, if let him be sounds cold and disinterested, It isn't. Let them be is not cold and disinterested. There's nothing I can do. My son Joe committed suicide. There's not a darn thing I can do about any of that. So let them be is the only sane choice. It sounds cold, but it's not. I'll give you a quick example. I was adopted into a really good family, and so I don't have a lot of profound hatred and resentment against family members and friends. My profound hatred and resentment is against colleagues and other musicians. If I think they're going to get my business away from me, or if I think they might be better than me, there's some profound. I had lots of little incidents, like a guy cut me off on the highway one time and I chased him 20 miles. And I cut him off. I showed him. I'm sitting on the top of this exit ramp after chasing this guy for 20 miles and I realize I'm 20 miles past my exit. So I'm late for my meeting. But so I had a lot of incidents like that, but I didn't have a lot of profound hatred against family members and close people. But I'll give you a quick example of the way this stuff has turned around for me. When I started to do this kind of work with Rick about 15 years ago, we were driving to Wisconsin, driving from Minneapolis up to Wisconsin to do one of these workshops. And there was a highway construction project. There were two freeways that blended together, and it's been a disaster in the Twin Cities for years, where if you're on this freeway, you got to be on this side, and then to stay on this freeway, you got to cross to the other side. So you get traffic crossing, and it's just crazy. So they got a program to fix this. So I'm complaining, and we're driving on this freeway, and I'm complaining about this freeway. I have to drive to work every day on this thing, and oh, this freeway is so bad, and it's so crazy. We were prepared to look at it. We turned back to the list where it held the key to the future. We were prepared to look at it from an entirely different angle. Now, this has been a huge key for me, an entirely different angle. So we're driving along, I'm complaining about this freeway. Rick says, you know, think about the genius involved in doing this work on this freeway and still keeping it open for traffic. I mean, this, I don't know if you know anything about driving in Minneapolis, but this particular place, if they shut down these freeways, there is literally no way to get from where I live to downtown. Seriously.
You and know, I'd watch them change entrance ramps and exit ramps. And I mean, they're shifting traffic. It was crazy.
Yeah.
But it was working, man. You could still get through, and they kept this thing going. I was quite impressed with what they did.
So, an entirely different angle.
Huh?
Listen, I admitted earlier that I've been clueless my whole life. I don't claim to know anything.
I would drive through in wonder, and he's hating it.
Yeah. But when he said that, this entirely different angle kicked in, and it was just gone. And I drive on that freeway every day, and I've never had that feeling come back. I've never had that come back. I would love to say that I'm perfect and I never get angry. I'd like to think that now if the guy cut me off on the freeway, I'd only chase him a couple of blocks. You know, what's happened to me as a result of doing this, and I'll probably talk later about how I got started doing this in the first place, but I literally, as much as I'd like to sometimes, I can't stay angry anymore. I can't stay angry. This is not me doing this. I get angry. I'm a guy. We all get angry. I get mad at stuff. And even if I want to stay mad, I can't stay mad. It's like a few minutes and it's gone. It's gone. Because it's this entirely different angle. This guy did, well, what about you? Maybe that guy's got a family. Maybe that guy, maybe he's, what does it say? They, like ourselves, are sick too. Maybe this guy needs a break. I mean, that kind of thinking has caught on to me and I can't stay angry. And the feeling is just amazing. Because I don't walk around with those anger feelings anymore. And that's a direct result of this.
I think Bob said something that's really important here, is that this part where it says we were prepared to look at it from an entirely different angle, if you can keep from thinking you know what that angle is and just be willing to look at it differently, don't try and determine what it is. Go into the fourth column with an openness, not, well, I think it should look this way or that way. All you'll do is reallusion to something you like better.
Right. Now, this has come to me, and I realize this very clearly. If I have zeroed in on something that I want, I have my mind made up how something should be or what I want, what kind of result I'm looking for, then I am closed to any alternative. I'm zeroed in on this is what it should be. I'm not going to see any alternative. If I can be open to other ideas, I've had things happen to me that I had no idea where they came from. They just happened because I wasn't insistent on it's got to be this way. That's that selfishness. It's got to be this way. And if I can shut that off and say I'm willing to consider whatever it is, I'm willing to challenge my ideas. And that's been the result for me. And I probably don't have any right to be here. I had open heart surgery 15 years ago. I'm 50 pounds overweight. I'm in terrible shape. I probably shouldn't even be here. I probably shouldn't even be alive at all. I think I'm a walking example of when the spiritual malady is overcome, we straighten out mentally and physically. I'm pretty sure that's what's going on in my life because I feel great. I feel great, and I don't have any justifiable reason for it except I feel great. It's this. It's God in its inventory in Alcoholics Anonymous. That's what it is for me.
You know, I can give you another example of a really bad result that you get from holding grievances that you might not be aware of, or you might be. I don't know if you are or not. But it was revealed to me in a way that was very upsetting at the time. When I grew up, I hung around with a guy in the neighborhood named Randy. Randy and I drank together. We went to school together. We sniffed glue together. We went to jail together. We did everything together. He had a little sister, Colleen, and she's 3 years younger. And we used to hang out together. We'd babysit her, drag her around. And, she, you know, we were, I mean, we'd do crazy stuff. We'd be down switching tracks at the railroad yard with Colleen. You know, she'd be about 7 years old and we were 10, you know. And the cops would be chasing us and we'd each have a hand on her. Her legs aren't even touching the ground. We're running away from the cops, you know. This is the kind of stuff that we were, you know. Then Randy and one of his other friends would teach her how to play poker. And they'd take all her babysitting money or whatever she was doing to get money. I don't know. It was kind of weird, actually, the way they treated her. But anyway, so we're hanging out. And Randy started working for me. I was a contractor. I am a contractor. But I was doing remodeling at the time, and Randy was working for me. And, you know, you build cases with your buddies. You know, I'd be off getting some materials. I'd come back. Nothing seemed to get done. You know, you get that kind of crap going on between you. We've known each other all our lives, all right? And now we're in our 20s. And Colleen, I was supposed to go on a fishing trip. Opening fishing weekend is Mother's Day in Minneapolis, in Minnesota. And I was supposed to go up on a fishing trip with a friend, with her fiance, Colleen's fiance. And I also had a house listed with a realtor friend of mine, all right? And we hadn't quite put it on the market yet, but he wanted to put it on the market, and he wanted to do it maybe on that Mother's Day. I was going to drive up. Craig was going to ride with me on this fishing trip, and the muffler fell off of my car. And I thought, well, now I can't drive, so I have to ride with them. And I'm talking to Dallas, the guy who's the realtor, and he says he makes a decision at the last minute. I says, you really want to list this on Mother's Day? Nobody's going to be in town. He says, let's do it. So I stayed in town. They were killed on the way up north. Yeah, just like that, I slipped out of that one. Isn't that something? We used to talk about seconds and inches. Yeah. So anyway, there it was. He's killed, Colleen goes crazy, and she goes into the drug world, and she's a mess for years. And I mean, she was a mess. Hanging around with a lot of band members, just it was absolute chaos for her.
Well, that's a problem right there. Eh?
Well, they're all doing dope, you know. They're just crazy, you know. It was chaos. They're all hanging around her place. It was really a crazy place, man. I mean, there was some heavy drugs going on in that one. So, I didn't see a lot of Colleen because I wasn't interested in that scene. I was trying to work and I was trying to make money. But Randy's working with me, and I got this. Information from Randy about his dad. Apparently Randy's dad had a house. The guy next door was tearing off the roof and he damaged the siding on his dad's house. And they said, well, we're going to take this is what they presented to his dad. We're going to take some siding, because it's siding you can't purchase anymore. It's this old asbestos siding. We're going to take some siding off a dormer up above, patch it down below, re-side it up there with some aluminum siding, and paint it to match a house. I said, that's not acceptable, Randy. Let me talk to your dad. Let's get together. We'll have a meeting with your mother and dad, and we'll go talk to him. I says, I'll get this guy to have to side the whole house. That's nothing illegal about that. I can push this issue. See, looking for some way to make some money, take advantage of somebody else. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying that's what I did. You know, that's what my motive was. So I figure I can make some money on this deal. Sit down in the living room. Randy's dad is named Roman. His mother was Ruby. And Randy and I are sitting in the room. We made a deal. I says, Roman, I'll tell you what, I'll deal with the insurance company as your agent, as your contractor. I'll get them to re-side the whole house, okay, in terms of dollar figure. And then we'll take some siding from above and patch it down below. See, it's not acceptable if they do it. It's okay if we do it, but it's, you understand, don't you? Yeah. So, and then we'll split the difference on the money, what's left over. Now, his dad's a drunk. He kind of likes this idea of free money. You know, it's a great idea, right? So, I contact the insurance company, and I did just that. They were offering him $350. I got him $3,500. Well, we did a little work on his house. We laid a little bit of carpeting and put some gutters up and a few things. Nothing too extensive. Randy was working. I was figuring out what the labor and all this stuff was. His dad was paying him direct. And then we were going to split what was left over after we did the work. We got it. So now I'm cashing checks. This is like Tuesday in the week, and I'm writing checks, and I expect a payday on Friday because the work's almost done. We get to Friday. I call his dad up. I got about $500-$600 worth of checks that are getting the bank pretty quick. I call his dad up. I said, Roman, I figure you owe me about $1,000. There's a couple grand left over after what we did. His dad says, there's no money left. I said, what do you mean there's no money left? Of course there's money left. There's no money left. There's money left. No money left. Hangs up. Won't talk to me. Call him back. Hangs up. Won't talk to me. I'm in trouble. I got these checks coming in. I got to cover this stuff. It's going to cost me a fortune to start bouncing all this stuff. Wow. I call up Randy. I said, Randy, you got to help me with this, man. You were sitting right in the living room when we made this deal. You know what the deal was. He says, I can't do that. I'm living off of my dad upstairs. I'm not going to fight. I says, Randy, if my dad did this to you, I'd kill him for you. Well, that really wasn't so noble. I wanted to kill him anyway, you know. It sounded kind of good at the time, you know, but I'd kill him if he did that to you. You know, what a noble guy I am, huh? He says, I won't do it. I said, that's it. I'm done with you. See, I'm pissed at him already about other things. And I used this situation to just blow him out of my life. And I did. I just simply blew him out of my life. He lost his best friend. He lost his job. And I never saw him after that. Isn't that great? That's the way I treat my friends. You guys know what I'm talking about. Some of you have probably done that kind of thing. So here it is. 15 years later, something like that. I'm in AA. And I'm about a year sober, and I'm reunited with Colleen. She's out at this big roundup that we have in May, and I'm excited about AA. And now I see her. She's 3 years sober. I didn't even know she was sober. I bump into her. Now we're hanging out. Now this is a beautiful woman. I mean, physically very beautiful. But we're like brother sister. There's nothing going on there. You know, never has been, and I've never felt that way with her. You know, but she is strikingly beautiful. She really is. So we're hanging out, we're going to meetings, and of course, you know, AA people, they all think you're sleeping with anybody you go into a meeting with, you know, so the gossip's going and all this crap because they see me with some other woman here, and oh, Jesus, you know, it's amazing the way we are with that stuff. So we're hanging out probably 2-3 times a week. We're going for walks around the lakes. Minneapolis got these big lakes in the middle of the city. It's really quite a very beautiful city. And we're hanging out. We're doing stuff. Summertime, it's a great, you know, we're just having fun. And I notice as I'm hanging with her, after about 2-3 months, I'm becoming increasingly uncomfortable as I'm around her. And I don't know what it is. I just feel there's something about her that bugs me. I don't know what it is. And one day I'm walking along with her and I'm looking at her and I think, you know,
I don't really like her nose very much, and something about her feet that bother me, and her leg, you know. And I'm not kidding you guys, I'm picking her apart, and this is the strangest thing in the world. And it's getting in the way, and thank God she's not acting weird, or I would have blown her out of my life, too. If she'd have been acting any way strange, I would have said, yep, she's a jerk, I'd have just blown her out, see? But I couldn't do that. I couldn't do it, because she wasn't doing anything. I couldn't play it. Not that I wanted to, but I mean, you know how the ego is. It's always trying to sabotage everything. One day it dawns on me, and I'm telling you, I was really getting to where I couldn't stand to be around her. And this is a lovely lady, both in personality and in looks. One day it dawns on me, my God, I'm not seeing her, I'm seeing Randy. These are features that she has that are reminding me of my hatred for her brother. And it is making the picture of her ugly. You think this doesn't go on? It goes on all the time when you've got a grievance. And I gotta tell you, I had to take a look at that situation again. And I went back in my mind and I wrote this thing out looking at that resentment I had toward her brother. And you know what I found out? I had an expectation that Randy should save me. It wasn't his battle, first of all, okay? The other thing is that I didn't want to take responsibility for my failure to write a contract. I could have held his dad contractually, but I did it verbally with him, see? And that's my fault. That wasn't Randy's fault. That was my responsibility. There was nothing illegal about what I did. It might have been immoral, but it wasn't illegal, see? And I could have held his dad to a contract on that thing, and I didn't handle the business end of it right. And it had nothing to do with Randy. Yet I wanted Randy to fight my battle for me. And one more time, I put it on somebody else instead of taking responsibility for my crap. And I saw it. Wow. And the resentment went away. Did I pardon Randy for being a jerk? No, I saw that I was wrong. Here, I blew this guy out of my life. He lost his best friend. He lost his job. How do you make an amend for that? I mean, what do you do with that stuff? Well, I had to sit down and talk to him. It wasn't easy to talk to Randy. He's still drinking, see, at the time. And I gotta tell you, I sit down, I'm trying to talk to him at a bar, I'm buying him dinner, and I'm trying to have a conversation. He won't shut up. And I finally said, Randy, shut up, I got something to tell you. And I made my amends as best I could to him, and I told him how I regretted what I did, and I was very sorry for what I did to him. And I knew I couldn't make it up, and I really, really felt terrible that I had done that to him when it had nothing to do with him. Isn't that sad? You get caught in a situation like that. Well, best I could do, guys. What are you going to do with that thing? You know, I tried to be friends with him a little bit. You know, he died not long ago. He drank on with hepatitis C. And, you know, he's 50 years old and he died, and I was at his bedside, and I was there with his sister Colleen, and I spent some time with him while he was dying. And I had a chance to be there. Best I could do, guys, that's all I could do with that one, you know, but it's sad. Well, I'll tell you, the good news out of all this is that when I see Colleen today, I don't see Randy anymore. See, the anger, the hatred was darkening the picture of others. And if you think this doesn't happen, it's going on all the time. Before I resolved my resentment with my dad, I used to walk into our club and I had this anger toward my dad, and there was a guy sitting at the front desk. We had got a club. It's a huge building and it's an old mansion, and you walk in and there's a guy at the front desk, and it's in a kind of a crappy area, but it's, you know. And so they got a guy there. It's called 2218 is the name of the club. And it's also the address. He's sitting at the front desk. Every time I hit the front desk, I feel uncomfortable around this guy. And I don't like him. I don't know why I don't like him. And I'm skirting around and that sort of thing. And pretty soon he sees me acting this way. I don't say hello to him. So pretty soon he's acting weird around me. And I look at him and I think, yep, he is a jerk. See? Wow. This guy was doing nothing. One day it dawns on me, he's got a nose like my dad's. He's got a nose like my dad's. I hate my dad. I'm not seeing that guy. I'm seeing my dad. How many relationships have I spoiled over things like that? How many people have I had grievances or uncomfortableness around, and I didn't know what it was, and I wouldn't get to know them? Because if I got to know them, certainly then I might see something that I might like them, you know, and then my case gets blown apart, and you might have to look at yourself, right? But how many times has that happened to any of us?
How stupid is that? He doesn't like the guy's nose. Are you kidding me? First time I heard Rick say that, that's the dumbest thing I ever heard. I got into a business deal with a guy. This is some years ago. I got into a business deal with a guy, and I just could not get along with this guy. I was sure he was cheating me, and his demands were unreasonable. And I realized that he reminded me of a guy that I had had a lot of trouble with years earlier. It was exactly the same situation. This guy looked like a guy that I'd had. Once I got rid of that and started dealing with this guy instead of that image, we got along fine. He's a nice guy and everything worked out fine. So I heard him say that. I thought it was really stupid, and I went out and did exactly the same thing. Same thing happened to me. So if you think that stuff doesn't happen.
How come I don't like people and I don't know them? How come they bug me? You see a guy in a meeting, you just can't stand him. You don't know what it is. Just hate him. Huh? Yeah, it's his nose or something, you know, or... Contempt prior to investigation. Yeah, yep. It is.
Thanks, Larry. Contempt prior to investigation.
You bet. Isn't that something, though? So you think you don't pay a price for this stuff? I almost ruined a relationship with a very dear friend over my stuff. And I was sober for a while at that point. You guys, so you get the picture of how damaging this stuff really is if you start to look at it. I am a good example of a bad example. I want you to understand that. That's why I'm here. You know, it's a... I've been particularly stupid around these things, okay? But you know what? I've been willing to learn. I've been willing to learn. And that's what's had to happen for me. So, guys, I really appreciate your patience with this stuff. And these are things that have been important to me, and they're things that have altered me. And it's made a big difference in my life. So whenever I bump into that stuff, I take a look at myself. I look at it. Why am I uncomfortable? Why do I keep putting my stuff on other people? We love to project. That's what we do. We project onto others. It's hard to believe. But whenever I'm disturbed, no matter what seems to be the cause, today I know there's something wrong with me. Yeah, there might be something wrong with the other guy. Maybe he needs to change, but that's not the point. That's not the point. Why does it bug me and it doesn't bother Bob? Or another guy? There's always somebody who'll see him differently. How come that guy likes him and I hate him? Where's the problem? That's what I've had to look at. So,
well, perception. It's all about perception. Anybody having, in the last few days, anybody had a bad day? Huh? Anybody had a good day? Okay. Suppose I had a really good day today, and you had a really bad day today. Is it the day? There's nothing wrong with the day, is there? It's our perception of what's happening. The day is innocent. We do that all the time. We project stuff outside here. We get, when there's something wrong, when I'm upset, what Rick said, I got to look at me. I don't got to look at you and see what's wrong with you. I have to look inside and see what's wrong with me. What's disturbing me?
Yeah, when Pam left me, it didn't hurt Bob. You know, it didn't hurt Bob at all. So it must have been my thoughts. I was hurting myself with my thoughts about the situation. This is always the case for me. And the more I've taken responsibility for it, well, it's like Big Rodney said, you know, taking responsibility for your own happiness frees me from others' control. And pretty soon nobody can control you, because your happiness is not outside of yourself. If my happiness is outside of myself, I'll be unhappy when I don't have what I want. See, this is a problem. Once you start realizing this, you take your power back, and then pretty soon, nothing really can hurt me. Without my permission, of course. I just give my permission, that's all. So,
this is such great news that, you know, we have to take responsibility for stuff. We have to look at inventory. I have to admit I'm wrong about things. Okay, that's tough. I don't like to do that. But the good news is, I have control over that. Yeah. It's not, the world is not attacking me. It's not, nobody can make me drink. Nobody can make me feel bad. That's me doing that.
Man, you want to be happy or right.
Yeah. And if I'm doing it, you know, it's as simple as if I'm doing it, I don't have to do it. If I'm doing something that makes me miserable, I don't have to do it. That's really how simple it is.
Well, thanks again, guys. It's been a pleasure.